Please welcome with me Patrick Lohbacher.
Thank you. Yeah, welcome to my talk about two buzzwords, digital transformation and agile enterprise. I try to coin a new buzzword later on. So the problem is, as with my last talk, is thinking stuff included for everyone, but no type is real at all. But as the last talk, it is necessary, I think, to think about these things for every agency or every company dealing with type 3 as well, of course. So, just a few words to us, to the Plus work. We are doing a lot of type 3 stuff, Magento stuff as well. We are founded 6 years ago. We have more than 130 people around South Africa and Europe. And we are taking care about the digital transformation as a full service agency in this area. And in this area, we have a consulting part. It's growing bigger and bigger because the problems are getting more and more complex. It's not that easy that you say, okay, you need a Type 3 website. What should we do? Now it's about digital processes, about communication structures, about systems. It's more and more complex. And so, of course, the main pillar is the agency part. But we have the systems part as well, because even operations is going more and more complex here. And in the consulting part, we are divided in three areas. So it's innovations. And this is interesting because the whole event here is called innovation as a subtopic. And we think that innovation is one of the most important driver for the future, perhaps for the present as well. And we'll see a few of these examples as a real practical example later on the slides. Then the people part, of course, and the processes part, where we're doing a lot of consultancy work, but not in a classical one. So we don't make concepts and put it on the desk and say, so that is right, because we don't know how it's right. We want to enable the companies to find out what's right. Yes, a few references. So, what the hell is an agile enterprise? Perhaps you haven't read this term before, I don't know. Could be another bullshit bingo, Hall of Fame word. The problem with buzzwords is they are not correct in any way, but they are needed. So, buzzwords are needed to address the topics, to get attraction to topics, and to reflect important aspects. And so the digital transformation is just the wrong term. I think it's wrong, the digital one and the transformation one. But it's the correct buzzword for addressing all these things which are already here and which are coming up in the future. So I have to go back in history, unfortunately, to explain, because we have seen a lot of interesting topics today, a lot of interesting things to do, what we can do and how we can change us, but perhaps there's no need to change, so why should I change anything? And I will show you that it's important to change all of the aspects of your company. It started with the first industrial revolution in terms of what is important for companies, of course. And it was, the first mechanical loom, then it goes on with the second industrial revolution about 100 and a few years later, another 100 years or 120 years later, the third industrial revolution. So we have another 100 years time, but this doesn't work out, because we had the fourth revolution about 20 years between or after the third revolution. And it's getting more and more complex, and it's getting so complex in a dramatic way that it's not just a step in history, it changes everything radically. So it's, of course, it's with the invention of the computers, it changed a lot, but with the internet and the network structures and so on, the cyber physical systems, if you want, then it's changed dramatically. And the problem is that the tools we use today in the most of our companies are made for the second industrial revolution. They are invented there. project management, for instance, or something like this, waterfall, Gantt diagrams, and so on. And we have tools from the third revolution, so it's Scrum, Agile, if you want, incarnation of Lean. So Lean was invented in the 50s, but the incarnations in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. But we have no proper tools for the fourth revolution today. No working tools, because the experience is missing in this area. And the problem is, if you use tools from the second one, then we get stuck at some point. And now, yes, it depends on your company, on your structure, on your dynamic, on the market. A few companies are aware that the old tools doesn't work, and they change fast, I would say. And the other say, why using Scrum? Why I should use Scrum? It's okay with Waterfall. Make fixed price offers, and it worked out for 30 years, so it will work out for the next 20. And they will fail, I guess. Just an imagination. Just think about a rocket start. So what is needed for a rocket start, of course, we have to calculate a lot of things, program code, because I want this rocket to be on the moon or something like this. We need a lot of knowledge, so we hire a lot of physics and engineers and something like this. Then we have a waterfall planning, of course, because we have one try. So we press on the button, and then if there is a mistake or an error in there, then we've heard this news where the rocket will explode because some engineer made a mistake. But this is how the most people are dealing with projects, for instance, still now. So we are, I think, we are much further, but it's not common that projects will be done in an agile way. And if you think another example, let's say you are in a car and you're driving on the street, and yes, you don't need any knowledge, perhaps about is red the color I have to stop or is green the color. Okay, this is knowledge, but the rest is skills. You have to have skills. So if you are a beginner, then it's hard to drive this car. If you're an intermediate or an expert, it's easy. So you can even phone in the same time or talk or something like this. You have small iterations because you're driving, and then there is, let's say, something on the street. Then you turn around, or you stop, or you see the light, or something like this. You don't care about. You interact with the situation. You have ongoing corrections, of course. If the street is broken or something like this, then you turn right and take another way. And you learn from mistakes. So if you are aware that fast driving is not that good for you because the concentration is not high enough, then you will slow down a bit or something like this. This is a self-organizing or self-reacting system, although the car itself is complicated, obviously. And this is the difference. This is a complex situation where you can't predict what exactly happened on your tour from Munich to Cologne or to Vienna. You don't know it exactly. You can't calculate it. You can't make a plan. You know there's a few streets and you will turn on the A1 after this crossing or something like this, but you can't predict the future here. And this is the difference between complicated and complex. And I think this is the main difference between these two ages of the third revolution and the fourth revolution. So enterprises are getting more and more complex as well, and this is the problem. And employees too, because they have they're so different. They're not these workers like in the fabrics in the last century or something like this. They are knowledge workers. They are smart creatives. The markets get more and more complex every day. So we have these markets which are connected in the internet. We have your competitor beneath you, and you think you have a perfectly running business. And then someone comes from the US or from China and has the same offer for you in a short time. And structures are getting more and more complex, and dynamics, and so on. And anything is getting more and more complex and therefore unpredictable. And that's the problem. We can't predict it. And we can't use tools which helps us to find more prediction. So I can make more plans to have more prediction, perhaps. Doesn't work out. Absolutely not. One tool which is, I think, good to understand the things working together is the Stacey matrix, which has on the x-axis the variability. So how variable is this? What you want to do? Let's imagine you have just one room with a few chairs. Then that's no problem to imagine. And if you should calculate the time you need for the chairs to put it on the right side, no problem. It's easy. So the requirements are easy. It's on the epsilon axis. The unknown and the variability is known too. So it's just a simple one. Do it. Make a small plan if you want. No problem. If the requirements are in the middle and the variability too, then it's a complicated situation you have. And complicated situations are best to handle with a plan. That's perfectly fine. So you can do waterfall approaches if it makes sense, of course. The problem, and you see it here, the red color is more than two times present. The most situation you will approach, you will get in contact with your company, is a complex situation. And complex situations can't be handled with waterfall plans. Yes, there should be another way. It's called Agile, and we will see Agile and Lean. It's some approach between, and it's not necessary that Scrum is the answer for this, even if you are not in the programming business, although the Scrum works in every environment, so it doesn't have to be in the programming environment or something like this. And if the chaotic one, then it's all gone. Okay, Agile and Lean. What are the summaries of them? So I don't want to separate them, just to find something which is in common. So it's value-based, for instance. So it's not about rules, not about plans or something like this. It's about values. And it's the same for leadership, it's the same for programming, it's the same for team building and something like on focus, openness, courage, commitment, transparency, and so on, and so on. This is really, really important for Agile or for Agile and Lean environments. Teamwork is more and more needed, so it's not possible to drive a whole company with just single positions sitting in single rooms and don't talk to each other and don't work with each other. So teamwork is the model of the future. It's the model of the present as well, of course, but in the future nothing will work with teamwork. Feedback systems are that important. So you have to get feedback, more feedback than today. No, not one feedback meeting with your boss or something like this. That's not possible. You have to have immediately feedback all the time. That's important. Iterations and increments in everything you do. Continuous improvement, of course, because you have to improve your processes, your products, your communication, your leadership. Avoidance of waste, which comes from lean, of course, and leadership instead of management. And this is a really, really important topic, the last one, because not that many people are aware that there is a big difference between these two terms. So what is the enterprise stack, or what is the company stack normally? If you want, there's a culture stack, of course. So you have perhaps a top-down culture. It's in the most companies. So we have perhaps a family culture. It's in every company where there's one boss on the founder, perhaps the entrepreneur. You have a family culture, if you want or not. It is like this. So it's the founder. Okay, I can do it by myself, but sometimes I want to ask him because it's his company. Yes. That's sometimes a problem, sometimes it's really good for growing, for small companies. It could be very, very agile itself. Strategy is mostly an annual static planning, or biannual. Goals are cascading, waterfall goals, so the boss has some goals and gives it in the cascade to the next level, to the middle management, for instance, and then to the employees. Everything is fine. The tactics is planning, because if you are in a meeting and say, oh, let's do this event, who can do it? We need a plan first. That's good. Okay, you make the plan and then we meet again in 1 week and then we look about it. That's normal. And the operations is waterfall, of course. So now we are striving for more agility and we say, oh, let's introduce Scrum. Then we are agile. And I've talked to many companies and they say, we are totally agile. Okay, what have you done? Yeah, we are using Scrum. Really? How many teams? One. Okay, one team. Okay, with how many people? 5. Okay, and the whole company? 500. So nothing is done in terms of Scrum, of course. So it's one single island there. But it's okay, we have a few stages to go, no problem. So the next, if you have more than 2, 3, 4, 5 Scrum teams or Kanban or something different, then sometimes you will say, we have an agile culture because Scrum needs a culture change. So we have seen this in the last talk by Gina. Of course, you have to give trust to the employees. They are self-organizing. Then you are courageous, open, transparency will come. And then you have an agile culture. That's good, but that's half the way, I think. Okay, the next one is if you're getting more and experiments, you say, let's change the tactics. We have just this planning thing, so we invent a new product, we sit together, we plan this product. Of course, it will be developed in Scrum teams and then shown to the customers. But yeah, we have half a year development time or a year, and then we have a great product, and then we come out and launch it, and nobody wants it. There's something wrong. I don't know why. That's so good, the idea is good, the CI is good of the product, the website, the AdWords are good, but nobody wants it. And that's the lean startup approach, to go to the customer and say, okay, how can I verify that this, what I want to do, or the plan to do, is needed by the customer. I will come to this back later. The next one, going from annual static planning to data-driven planning, for example. That's okay too, just to validate what has happened in my company. Is it needed what I have to offer? To go iterative strategy and not the single point of big strategy, which I place on the table and say, so this is our plan for 5 years. It doesn't work, for example. And this is the most important thing and the most difficult thing, the hypothesis validation. So if you ask someone in a company, and you're doing Type 3, you're doing it well. Oh, yeah, yes, we're doing it perfectly well. Okay, what is your USP? Don't know, don't understand. USP, what are you doing better than the others? Oh, we are doing high quality. No, it's the same with all. Okay. We are doing it to a price the customer can afford. The most do. So it's and then they say something like, we have direct contact to the customer, he can call us, and so on, and so on, and so on. And then you see there's no USP, no real reason to go to this company. It's not there. It's by accident. So they are searching for the company, and sometimes the search page shows this on the top, or perhaps they talk about or something like this. And if you haven't USP, and or if you search for a USP, you have to validate it. And that's the problem with most companies, so they don't validate the hypothesis that they are unique in some aspects of their doing. Yes, and the goal one, unfortunately, it's the last one. Many of the companies will care about. And they say OKR or something like this. There are more. There are 4DX and WOL and something like this. But this is the last on the list. They do, unfortunately. So, and the problem is not the problem. Therefore, it's another color. Even in the culture, I think there have to be more change than just being agile in a way. And so. Felipe Castro, one of the goal management gurus, if you want, from Brazil, has written down the seven A's of culture, so agility, agnosticism, asymmetry, autonomy, alignment, accountability, and authenticity. So, and you see many of the things we've already heard in the talks. There is purpose is important, alignment, feedback, self-managed teams, so data-driven by agnosticism. It's important to work on the culture, and I think that culture is one of the most important aspects in a company, even if they have a really good product, and the product is running on the market and is perfectly fine, and everyone will buy it. If the company will ever fail, then it's in terms of the culture, I think. Even with big growing companies, of course, but even with settled companies. So in our work, we discovered that the customer says, okay, I understand, but what is my level? If you say the digital maturity level, the digital transformation stops here, it's wrong, of course, but here's 100% and here's zero, where I am. So this is the first question the customer asks, and therefore we developed this digital maturity level just to show them in which aspects they are really, really, on the right way, and which aspects they are missing in their daily work. And so it starts with the strategy, of course. So you need a digital strategy, not just a normal strategy. You need a strategy which reflects the today's markets and changes and the digital transformation. It's not enough to say, I just want to be the market leader in some market niche or something like this. Leadership is, of course, is no order. It's not the important one, but it starts often with the strategy. The leadership one is more important than before, because before it was relatively easy. You had managers, and they have tasks, and they have to fulfill this task. And at the end, there were employees lead by the managers. And it doesn't work. So the management will have different tasks in the future. So it will be more a servant leader, a supporter or something like this, but not someone who says, you have to do this and you have to do that. Then, of course, people, most important one, culture, processes, so like Scrum, Kanban, and so on. Products, of course, so you have to think about the products you offer. Think about Kodak, for example. They invented the digital photography, but they don't believed in. So they said, digital photography, no, nobody wants to have a photo on a chip. They want to have these big cameras, and it's more important, and now they are gone. Or the same with Nokia, for example, market leader. So technology, of course. Which technology you offer, but which technology you use is important too. The next one, processes, of course, products, technology, data, customers, and last but not least, governments. Because I often hear in companies, if you ask them, what are you doing to fulfill the needs of the digital transformation? We have an innovation team. Okay, innovation team, great. What are they doing? They're sitting together once a week and talking. Oh, okay. And what is the output? I don't understand the question. Yeah, the output, what are you changing? No. They're just caring about innovation or changing. This can't be happen. You have to have governments there to bring it in every aspect of the company, to live it, to breath it. No, we are not that further, no. That's not possible with us. And that's the problem. And even with the big companies, with the big market players, they, of course, they care about innovation, but they are separated. It often starts with an incubator or something like this. That's okay. But you have to bring it in the company, in every aspect, in every room, in every corner. At the end, it's a not a complicated process, but it takes some time. There are many questions, a questionnaire. There are some audits from us where we have a look. Then we have such a diagram, but a few detailed results as well. And then we can talk about what happened to your leadership? Perhaps you have a problem with your leadership. So it's just the 3 of 10 possible points. So we discovered that there's a lack of leadership in this company. And then we can work with tools, which brings these aspects a bit further, or perhaps in some areas they are enough developed, if you want, and so we can go on with the consulting process here. Let's have a look on a few of these practical examples which can be done. So, for instance, OKR, which reflects on the digital maturity level, 1 for strategy, 2 for leadership, 3 for people, 4 for culture, and 5 for processes. Also, this OKR thing addresses these 5 dimensions and can increase it. So OKR stands for objective and key results. If you were in the talk yesterday, it's on YouTube in the meanwhile, I think. It's a method of defining and tracking objectives and their outcomes. And this is the main goal. So to align all of the employees to one right direction, and the direction is the mission statement, so the purpose, if you want, from the last talk, and the vision. And this is the right tool for this. It's not leadership. So you can't do leadership properly in a fast growing company, for instance, or in an unpredictable market. It's not possible, even possible. So you need new tools to do this, and OKR is one of the tools. There are many more tools. They even have no name, perhaps sometimes, but the art or the kind of leadership has to be changed there. The OKR cycle, we talked about this yesterday, and that's an agile way. If you have a look on this, then you see that it's a cycle. There are iterations. There are retrospectives for the continuous improvement. There is an alignment here. We have roles for this, and so on and so on. And the soul or the DNA of the OKR is just an agile method. Nothing more, nothing less. And therefore it works. So yesterday there were missing example missing, so I took one which was real from one of our customers. Reach top quality was the company OKR, for example. And therefore the team said, okay, let's do this. What improves the quality, or how can we reach the top quality? So we want to have less than 3 escalations per month. So for October, for November, for December. And after this, I have to do tasks to reach this, of course. But now I have key results, and I can measure it, and I can see, okay, we have 2 escalations for October. What happened? What went wrong, for example? Or 16 positive customer feedbacks. So what will I do as an employee? I will ask, are you happy with our service? And he said, yes, yeah, we're really, really happy. I write it down, and I fulfill my key result. And this is what OKR stands for, so that I have objectives, that I have key results, and then I have a clue what I can do next. What are my next tasks to fulfill them? And I have to focus on this one, or add at least 10 pages of documentation, or something like this. So there's a whole bunch of theory behind which are good or what are good key results and which are not. But these are working. Or design thinking. So it's really old. I think 40 years or 30 years, but now it pops on every innovation initiative thinking about design thinking. The digital maturity level says strategy, not leadership in this method, but people, culture, process, of course, products and customer are involved in this tool, and this tool was originally intended as an innovation method for products and services, but now it turns to be a complete new way of seeing people in relation to work, of imagination, concepts of work, and posing questions, how we live and learn. So it can change many aspects of our life, not just the products and services we want to offer, for example. There's a formal process behind, there are a few stages, there are a few other things. How many? 5? Huh? Okay, I have enough. That's great. A real example from our customer. IDICA in this case. IDICA has this, or some agency or some company sold them this feedback system. That's cool because there are 5 ugly smileys on there. A question nobody can read. And this is the middle best solution we found from the positioning. It was on a position that doesn't work. They had with about 1,500 customers per day, they had 5 feedback. And then the customer says, it makes no sense to pay that much money for this tool. So how can we improve this process? This was the question. And therefore, we started a 3-day design thinking workshop. We came up with a lot of more solutions than this one. But this has about 150 feedbacks per day. So we dramatically increased the feedback rate just with restricting to 3. The best smile is on the left side. It's just we have colors, we have a big question, it's white, it's not disturbing. So we couldn't find out this by just thinking about. We had to prove it. We had to build prototypes and to bring it to the customer and to revalidate it and so on and so on. And we have this, developed a lot of more of these feedback tools. You can't imagine. The best one was throwing a ball in a Röhre in such a thing. The red one, a green one, and the yellow one. It's because they have mostly elder customers, so they were 50, 60, and 70s up, and they don't want to touch on such an electronic device. They are not happy with this. So, okay, of course, it could be the future, but it isn't. And this was really good, so we have a feedback system in the market. Now you see the satisfaction of the customers live. So you can press on the different departments. We have 5 feedback system in the whole market, and you press it and you see a score. And that's amazing. Yeah, it works. Or Lean Startup. Yes, addresses a few of the digital maturity level dimensions as well. And in this method, technology and products, for instance, and it is just a method for teaching you how to drive a startup, how to to validate the idea of a startup in a really short time. So 3 days are totally enough to say if a idea works or not. You don't have to think about a half a year and spend a lot of money. Well, there's something missing. Oh, anyway. So we had an idea. We worked with IDICA on such a workshop as well, and we developed in a 3-day workshop as well a new product line for whole IDICA group. So totally new products which aren't on the market till now, and it was possible in 7 days with over 500 interviews to say it will or the success of these products are with a high. Yeah, with a high amount of feedback, will be a success. We don't know if it is a success in the end, so we have to produce one of them, then bring it in the stores, and then revalidate, of course. But it was possible to come to this point, and this is important. Or management 3.0, just another method we heard from China in the last talk. Where we, for instance, use at our customers and at ourselves as well this delegation cards for the delegation board, so that we can say, okay, we have some topic here, and what are our agreement of delegation, and then we put a card there, and so everyone in the company knows about, can I decide it by myself, have I to inform someone, or is it an area which is not for me. So it's complete by the other, or manage, or the other one is the moving motivators. So to find out the intrinsic motivation of the people, and what happens with the intrinsic motivators if I change something in the company. It's too complex to predict it. But when I say, okay, let's have an idea. What about if we are perhaps use a new technology in our company? what is with your motivators? Are they are are they reflecting this one? Is there a change in it? Is this an increasement or decreasement of some motivators? And so you find out with your team, with your colleagues, how you react on different changes in a complex system. And there are even more tools, of course. I skipped Scrum, I skipped Lean, Agile, and so on, Lego Serious Play, Big Data. But you see, there are new tools needed to handle this situation. A really interesting one is complexity tools, Komplexitoden of Deutsch, on German, complexity tools, where are a lot of tools are there to handle complex situations. Lean thinking, of course, and technology, don't forget the technology itself, because it's, of course, part of the digital transformation as well. These are the terms or the tools you should forget in the future, because they are from the legacy world or from the old world. So bosses hire. It's common. Of course, the boss will hire the employees, but makes it sense at the end? Or what job titles, for instance? That's funny. If you introduce job titles, let's say developer. So everyone, we are developers. And now you're a senior. Why is he a senior? I'm here in this company for 3 years. That's not fair. And then the trouble begins. So don't use this, if it's possible. Just one thing. If you, it's good to imagine, if you compare the digital transformation, the complexity of our world, if you compare it to one orange, then I think this, what the next 5 days will happen, is like this. So we have no clue how the complexity will grow in the next few years, even the next 5. And so we have to take care, and we have to adapt the tools for the tomorrow's world really fast to be prepared for this change which comes to us. So next step is to totally simply be courageous and curious and try, and fail. You will fail, of course, because there's no recipe for being successful, I think. But you learn only, perhaps, from these failings. So you have to fail. That's important. You have to be have to have an error culture and failure culture. Read books about these topics, because there are more and more books about digital business leadership. Is one of the latest ones. It's in German, agile Organisation. It's a topic you find anywhere on every blog, on every management newsletter, and so on. The HL organization, or auf dem Weg zur agilen Organisation. And we have recorded a video training with Christian together of digital transformation in companies. It's perhaps important too. And yes, that's all. So start being agile, I think. Yes, thank you. So, do you have any questions? No, then, if you have no questions, then you have to put this card into this bucket here. Otherwise, we can ask questions. No, just kidding. Okay, thank you. I'm here today evening or now. If you have questions, come to me, and then we can talk, of course. Thank you.
Thanks, Patrick.
Yep. Was it?
Clap, 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 clap. Okay, thank you.